to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
There arose a Pharaoh who did not know Joseph. Exodus chapter 1 and verse 8. Welcome to our study of living messages of the Old Testament. Today we're looking at the book of Exodus as we think about God's power and His deliverance of His people. Exodus is a very interesting book as we think about God's hand, His miracles, and His power in delivering His people out of captivity. The word Exodus itself is unique in that it means the way or the road out. Very practical lesson is that God will always deliver or find a way out for His people. If I trust God, just as the Israelites did, if I'm willing to find a way or follow God in His way, then God will always deliver and lead us toward that heavenly home. The key words are the word deliverance or redemption. God is delivering His people out of Egyptian bondage and captivity, and ultimately He is redeeming them for that Canaan land promise that He's made to them. Key verse to the book of Exodus would be Exodus chapter 6 and verse 7. Notice these words. The Scripture says, God speaking, I will take you as my people, and I will be your God. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God, who brings you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. Look at God's promise. I'll take you as my people. Look at the care and the love of God. I'll lead you out. I'll deliver you from your burdens. Friend, those same promises are made to each and every one of us. If we're willing to obey God, doesn't God take us as His children? We become adopted sons and daughters of God. Galatians 4 verse 4. We become a part of God's family. Ephesians 2 verses 14 through 16. And we have that great deliverance, not from Pharaoh, not from the Egyptian army, but deliverance from sin and from Satan, from a life of selfishness, if we're willing to obey the gospel. Key chapters to the book of Exodus, Exodus chapter 12, where that great Passover lamb is seen. God makes the deliverance for Israel, the ultimate climax in the burden under the Egyptians' hands. And now God delivers them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and that lamb, that Passover lamb, gives its blood so that the death one, the one who's going to bring the death over the firstborn, will not light on their house. Then in Exodus chapter 20, we see as well God making that great covenant, that great Ten Commandment covenant with Israel on Mount Sinai. He delivers the commandments, the law, and they begin entering into that relationship, that covenant with God. Key phrase in the book of Exodus is the phrase, let my people go. God says multiple times to Pharaoh, let my people go. Pharaoh hardens his heart. He resists the will of God, and as a result, God brings down the plagues upon him. You know, from that phrase, let my people go, you can see God's great care and His protection for His people. God has promised, you cast all your cares upon me, I care for you. 1 Peter 5 and verse 7. God has promised to aid and to help us in our time of trouble, and those who wreak havoc, those who do harm to the church of God and to Christians, they come under the vengeance and the power of Almighty God. When I think about Exodus, Exodus outlines very uniquely. It has three major sections. First of all, in Exodus 1 through 12, we see Israel in Egypt under bondage. Then in Exodus 12 through 18, we see Israel as they're journeying out of Egypt to Mount Sinai. And then we see Israel from Sinai on, Exodus chapter 19 through 40. And so we have their time in Egypt, their journey from Egypt to Sinai, and their time at Sinai as they begin to journey out toward the great promised land. And so it's all about the journeying, the way out that God gave to His people. But just as we noticed in Genesis, practical, powerful lessons for living, so today as we look at the book of Exodus, we want to notice that Exodus is not just the story of God delivering Israel. Exodus is a very practical book for each and every one of us. Here are some of the practical lessons that we see along the way in the book of Exodus. For example, in Exodus, we learn about reverence in worship. Notice what God says in Exodus chapter 3, verse 5 to Moses. Here's God's word. God says, "Then He said, do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground." You remember the background. Moses is on the backside of Midian, tending the flock. He looks up and he sees this bush on fire, burning, but it's not consumed. And so it piques his curiosity. He goes up to find out what this is, and there he draws near to that bush. And God says, "You take your sandals off your feet. Don't approach me with something unclean on. This is holy place." Friends, as we think today about a practical lesson, here's a very important one. When we draw near to God, when we come into His presence to worship, we need to realize we're on holy ground. That we need reverence as we worship the Almighty. And not only does God expect it, friend, there are great blessings and benefits in being reverent. Do you remember what the proverb writer said? Notice the words of Proverbs 28 and verse 14. Here's the benefit to us. The proverb writer said, "Happy is the man who is always reverent, but he who hardens his heart will fall into calamity." When I think about being reverent, not only is it what God expects, but it helps me to live a happy life because I know I'm in accord with the will of God. That's what God wants me to do, and I know I'm pleasing Him. Jesus taught us about worship in many places. He taught us not to listen to the commandments of the Pharisees and the Sadducees and those of men. Matthew 15, verses 7 through 9. He taught us the power of worshiping God correctly, just as He did in John chapter 4, verses 23 and 24. I want you to notice what Jesus said about worship and how this ties directly in with worshiping God reverently. Look at these words. Jesus said, "The hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship Him. God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth." We're here to worship the Almighty, the Creator of all things. And when we draw near to worship Him, we must worship in spirit. That's with our whole spirit, soul, mind, body, our whole being, and in truth. How do we worship God with reverence today? We put our whole being into it. This is not an idle adventure. It's not something that's mindless. It's not something we can just go and fill a pew and expect God to be pleased with that. You've got to be excited to worship God. You've got to be enthusiastic. It's got to be passionate as we worship the God of the universe. But then notice also, Jesus said, we must worship God in truth. What's it mean to worship God in truth? Well, here's what the biblical definition would be. Jesus said in John 17, 17, "Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth." If I'm going to worship God in reverence and I'm going to worship God in truth, that means I've got to worship God the way He tells me to in this book. I can't just do anything I want, anything I feel. I've got to do what God says when it comes to such items as praying. We need to pray with the Spirit and with the understanding. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 15. We need to pray according to the will of God. 1 John 5, verses 14 through 16. We need to pray in the name of Jesus. John chapter 15, verses 14 through 17. And We need to pray in such a way that it gives God the reverence and lifts up His name as high and holy. When we sing, we also need to sing with the spirit and the understanding. We can't just go through the song without thinking about the words. When we sing, we need to be excited about it. We ought to be passionate. We ought to think about and feel the meaning of those words as well. But when we sing, we need not make additions to the will of God. What if Moses had done something that God wasn't pleased with? Think about examples in the Old Testament. Think about Leviticus 10, Nadab and Abihu. Here you've got two young priests who are serving in the office of priests at the altar, and they're going to offer incense, and they offer, the Bible says, an unauthorized or a strange fire. How did God feel about that change? Friends, God rained down fire from heaven on those two young priests, and they died on the spot. We cannot make additions to or subtractions from what God asked. When God said sing, that's all that He wanted us to do. God didn't want me to pick a banjo or play a guitar or beat on a drum. When God said sing, that eliminates everything else. Sing and make melody where? In your heart. Ephesians 5:19 and Colossians 3:16. When someone says, oh, you know, I see what you're saying in some ways, but aren't you really picking at straws? Aren't you just trying to make a small item into something that's big? Not in God's view of things, and really not in our view either. For example, think about it this way. Let's say that you were going to order a pizza from a local pizza place. Say Pizza Hut or Domino's, wherever it may be. You call up and you say to that place, you say, I'd like a large pizza with pepperoni and black olives. Guy rings the doorbell about 30 minutes. He's got your pizza. He hands it to you. You pay him. You open that pizza up and it's got pepperoni and black olives, but it also has anchovies and pineapple. Now you look at that fella and you say, I didn't ask for this. How would you feel if he said, you didn't tell us not to? Would you take it? Would you pay for it? Would you be happy with that? Of course not. Why not? Because when you said what you wanted, that was all you wanted. Friend, the same is true with God. If I'm going to worship God reverently, I've got to do it exactly the way God says. God doesn't need my help, and God doesn't need your help. God simply wants me to obey Him. A second living message from the book of Exodus is that we see the great I Am in the power of God in Moses, through Aaron, and ultimately in Jesus. Exodus 3 verse 14, God is speaking to Moses and Moses has some questions. You want me to deliver these people? Well, who am I going to tell that sent me? And God says, I am who I am. You tell them, I am sent you. Past, present, future, encompassing all time and space. That's the very nature of God. Now, as we think about that great statement, you tell them, I am, past, present, future. Isn't that a perfect illustration of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? In fact, in John chapter 8 and verse 58, Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am. Jesus identified Himself as the great I Am. Not just as Jesus, not just the Christ, not just the Son of God, but God, part of the Godhead. Jesus is just as much deity as the Father and the Holy Spirit. In fact, did you know that God calls Jesus God? I want you to think about that for a minute. The Father calls the Son God. Look in Hebrews chapter 1 and notice what Hebrews 1 verse 8 says. The Scripture says, but to the Son, He, God says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. God the Father says to the Son, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. And so when we talk about Jesus and His power, here we see He is that great I Am. He is divine. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 1 verse 1, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory as the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John 1 verse 14, and so when I think of Christ, I don't just think of that one who came to earth, not just the one who made the great sacrifice. He is Emmanuel, God with us. Matthew chapter 1, verses 19 through 21. Another very practical lesson is seen in Exodus chapter 12, verse 23, as we see here the Passover blood and how it covered the people, and as we make application to our lives, the blood of Jesus as well. Look at what Exodus chapter 12 and verse 23 says. The Bible says, "For the Lord will pass through you to strike the Egyptians, and when He sees the blood on the lintel and on the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and not allow the destroyer to come into your house and to strike you." Here they've got that final plague. Firstborn's going to die, and yet in the midst of this, God makes a way out. You take a lamb, you kill it, you put its blood on the top and on both doorposts. When the destroyer sees that, he'll pass over your house. Now, friend, as we think about that Passover lamb, that's blood is shed, is there any type of that in the New Testament? You bet there is. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 7, Paul says, "And to Christ, who is our Passover." Jesus is our Paschal Lamb. He's the one whose blood is applied to our spirit so that we don't have to incur the results of sin, so that we can escape that which we rightly deserve. You see, friends, all of us have sinned. Romans 3, verse 10, "There's none righteous, no, not one. And because we have all sinned," the Scripture says, "the wages of sin is death." Do we deserve to die and spend eternity in hell because of our sins? Each one of us does. But the blood of Christ makes it possible for me and for you not to have to go to hell. God's grace and God's mercy are extended to us richly in Jesus Christ, and thus we can escape just as they escaped the destroyer. So we can escape today through the blood of Christ. Look at the words of Jesus as He instituted the Lord's Supper in Matthew 26, 28. Jesus said this, "For this is My blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many," watch this, "for the remission of sins." The blood of Christ is that which is applied to our spirit. Well, how does one have the blood of Christ applied to his spirit? You know, when we think about the blood of Jesus, we're talking about that great sacrifice. Zechariah chapter 13, verse 1 following, "A fountain would be opened for sin and for cleansing." John 19, 34, "When the soldier pierced the side of Jesus, forthwith came blood and water." We have redemption through His blood. Ephesians 1, verse 7, Colossians chapter 1, verse 14. We're washed in the blood of the Lamb. Revelation chapter 1, verses 4 through 6. How then does a person contact the blood of the Lamb? Well, if it is the blood of Jesus that washes away sin, we're washed in the blood of the Lamb, Matthew 26, 28, it's for the remission of sin. If the blood of Jesus must be applied to our spirit and it washes away, it cleanses us of sin, we ask then, at what point does a person contact the blood of Jesus? Romans 6 helps us with that. Romans 6, beginning in verse 1, Paul teaches us, "As many of us as were baptized into Christ were baptized into His death." When we contact the blood of Jesus, it is through the waters of baptism. When I obey the gospel, when I hear God's word, when I believe, when I repent, when I confess, and when I bring that in the final culminating step to baptism, that's when we contact the blood of Jesus Christ. Remember, it's the blood that cleanses us from sin. At what point can we find an account to know exactly when the blood is applied to our spirit? Can we know exactly when in conversion sins are removed? Absolutely. You remember the example of Saul? Acts chapter 9, verses 4 following. Saul, he's presented with that great light. "I'm Jesus. What would you have me to do, Lord? You go in the city, be told you what you must do." That must is found. That necessity is found in Acts 22, verse 16. Ananias comes to Saul, who's already been praying and fasting, and says, "Saul, Saul, why are you waiting? Listen now, arise and be baptized and wash away your sins," calling on the name of the Lord. Friend, if we don't think baptism is essential, we need to think again. Saul's sins were washed away at the point of baptism. We've already noticed that it is the blood of Christ that cleanses one from sin. Thus, it is at the point of baptism. Eye contact, the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, that's not the only account we see. There are multiple accounts that show us the essentiality of baptism in salvation and contacting the blood of Jesus. For example, that great day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, when they realize they've killed their own Messiah and they cry out, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Here was the answer. "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." He says, "For the promise is to you and your children and all those who are far off." When were they forgiven? Baptism was for the remission of sins. Peter makes it so clear. 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 21, Peter says, "Baptism does now also save us." But then there's another very practical lesson we learn from the book of Exodus, and that is that God is willing to fight for us and to fight with us. Exodus chapter 14, verse 1 following, God says to the people, "I'm going to be your God, I'll be with you, and I'll fight for you." Friend, I don't have to go it alone, and you don't have to go it alone. I have, first of all, the example of Jesus. Hebrews 4:15, He was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin. I can look at His example and I can say, the Lord's been here. I don't have to go down this road alone. Secondly, we have the power of prayer. Hebrews 4 verse 16 says, "We can come boldly to the throne of grace that we may find grace and mercy to help in time of need." James 5:16 says, "The effective fervent prayer of a righteous man overcomes much." I have the encouragement of other Christians. I know that God is willing to help. His Word shows me the perfect way. And so just as God was willing to fight for them, so God is also willing to fight for us. Now, another very practical lesson, idolatry is also condemned in the book of Exodus. God says in that great passage in Exodus chapter 20, verses 3 and 4, "You shall have no other gods before me." No idols, no other gods. I've got to be at the top of your list. Friend, do we have problems with idolatry today? Well, I don't know about you, but we don't have as many idols in the sense of statues and gods that people make with their hands per se. But don't we just as well have a problem with idolatry like they did? If an idol is anything that you worship and that takes precedence in your life, we've got problems with those today. Money is a lot of people's idol. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, beginning in verse 6, that the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, from which some have caused themselves great harm. Can money become an idol? Absolutely. Can stuff and junk and things of this world become one's idol? If all we think about and all we live for, new home, new car, new clothes, and all the worldly things, that becomes our idol. And friends, worldliness separates us from godliness. James 4 verse 4, James says, "Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore desires to be a friend of the world makes himself God's enemy." Another lesson from the book of Exodus that's a very practical lesson is we must never get caught following the crowd just because the crowd's doing it. You can't do what everybody's doing just because it looks popular. Oh, how memorable the words are of Exodus chapter 23 and verse 2. "You shall not follow a multitude to do evil." Friend, we need to realize that the multitude, many times in the Bible, wasn't pleasing to God. Noah and his family were the only ones saved because the rest of the world was living in wickedness. Look at Abraham and Lot in the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. It was Abraham and Lot's family, and that's it. When you think about throughout the Bible times, you can see that it's the few that have been faithful to God, and we must never follow the crowd just because the crowd's doing it. Now, here's the main reason not to follow the crowd. Don't follow the crowd because Jesus taught the crowd is going down the road that leads to eternal destruction. Notice the words of Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. Jesus said, "Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it." How many are going down that broad way, that way that leads to destruction? Jesus said, many. What about the way that leads to heaven? Jesus said, few. Don't follow the crowd. Do what's right, because it's the right thing to do, whether people like it and whether people like you or not. Ultimately, God will be pleased with that, and that's really what matters. Now, one last practical lesson, and that is from the book of Exodus. It's so disheartening to see the Israelites' sin of murmuring. Here is God, and God, by His powerful hand, leads them out of Egyptian bondage. They get on the other side. They're not even through the Red Sea hardly. Their feet are still have sand on it from walking through it. And what did they begin to do? "Oh, that we were back by the flesh pots in Egypt. Why have you brought us out in this desert to kill us?" And friends, it was because of that that the wrath of God came down upon those people, and they wandered in the wilderness of sin for 40 years. So someone said, "Well, what's that got to do with us today?" Here's the practical lesson. Philippians 2 verse 14 says this, "Do all things without murmuring and complaining, that you may be blameless as sons of God." How does that apply to me? I've got to realize in my life that things may not always go perfect. There'll be challenges, there'll be trials, there may be difficulties, but don't blame God. We need to realize that many of the problems we face are a result of our own sin, our own bad choices. And so don't murmur, rather, give thanks to God. For the Bible says in James 1 verse 17, "Every good and perfect gift comes down from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there's no shadow or variation of turning." And so we ask today, have you found the way out? The way out of sin? The way out of a life filled with sorrow and hurt? Are you through letting Satan lead your life? If so, won't you turn to God? Believe that Jesus is the Son of God. John 8, 24. Repent of things in your life that you know are not right. Luke 13, 3. Make that good confession. Acts chapter 8, verse 37. And won't you be baptized in water for the remission of sins so that you can have the hope of heaven? We hope you'll do that today as we study God's Word together. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wife.
This is the gospel of Christ.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study materials as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form, or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905. Or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee, 37114.
This is the gospel of Christ.